That's me, Jonathan Swift, Managing Editor of Education Today. We have about 40,000 teachers on our circulation list. We publish a mix of paper, which goes out to about 5,000 schools in the UK. We're a UK-based magazine. And the balance then goes out to teachers digitally. So we do a digital issue every month, which goes out to the balance, essentially 35,000. We send to schools rather than teachers the paper copy, because teachers change, move around, change job functions. Our magazine goes to schools. Okay, so just to give you an overview of what I'm going to talk about today, have a quick look at the educational press landscape, for want of a better term. So who are the players, who's out there? And I'll start at the top and work down. I'll talk a bit about doing it yourself, for those who don't use PR companies, the idea, you know, some ideas about how to craft press releases, some ideas about how to get in touch with journalists, how to have a meaningful conversation with journalists and editors. We'll look at PR. Is that something maybe you should be doing? And if so, you know, what are the good things about PR and maybe working with PR companies, and what are the less good things? Take a quick look at the UK's education press. I'll give you some rules, an overview of some of the do's and don'ts. So some of the things that don't work for me. So, you know, the likelihood of your news getting read. Examples of good practice and bad. And then again, some practical advice on getting your story read. So I'll make the case, as I say, for doing it yourself, because I think there are some good reasons why you should be doing it yourself if you're working as a supplier to the education sector. But also, take a look at PR, because we all know that PR are well connected. And then I'll draw it all together. So as we know, the press is an opportunity. I mean, all journalists want stories. All journalists, whether that's news organisations in print, broadcast or online, they're all looking for means and stories to fill their columns and pages and programmes. How do you tap into that? So some are looking for breaking news stories and are looking to tie in stories to breaking news. Brexit, for example, being the big story or whatever else. While others report it and reflect it, some do both. Now, as a magazine, we report news, we don't really break news, because we're a monthly magazine. So the scope for timely breaking news is less in our case. We have a website and we have a Twitter feed, and breaking news can feed into that. But for the most part, we just report news. But obviously, if you've got hot stories that are good to go, then you want those stories broken. It obviously represents an opportunity for your voice to be heard. If you are short on marketing budget but long on creativity and long on the ability to write good stories, then this is a great opportunity for you to get in front of the press and to get your stories out there. But again, there are some rules, and there are some helpful, I hope, pointers that will allow you to find your way around the landscape. And then timing is key. I mean, if you have a story that you want to break and the timing is good, then get it out there. But, and as I mentioned Brexit, please don't try and shoehorn your products into a story. Because there's one thing that I get quite a lot of since the referendum. Stories with you know, Brexit as the hashtag, if you like, and then it turns out to be a story about white screens or greenhouses in schools or something similar. So, you know, timing is key. It's good to get these things out there. It's good if they're relevant. But as a first top tip, please don't try and make a square peg fit into a round hole unnecessarily, because you will probably end up just getting an email back saying thanks, but no thanks, if you get anything back at all. So the press landscape, well, yeah, there's the major nationals, The Guardian, The Telegraph, The Times, and their Sunday sisters. And obviously that's, you know, if you like, that's the first tier. If you have something important that you want to say and you have people who are good at talking about education, then these guys are the people that I imagine you'd want to be talking to. The downside of these, the exposure is great. The downside, obviously, is getting hold of people. It's very difficult to get in touch with journalists on these big papers. Down the level, there's major national tabloids. Now, they tend to deal in outrage, for the most part, as we know. It depends what kind of story you're selling or what product or service you're selling. But normally, you'd be looking, I guess, towards this slightly more informed end of the market. If you're writing to the Daily Mail, you may get it published, but they will try and turn that into something that makes good copy for them, so always be aware. Then there's the regional papers. Now, regional papers are excellent for education stories because there's a lot of local interest in schools and local education. And obviously, you've got Standard in London, you've got Metro around the country, and then your local newspapers as well. I live in Crawley in West Sussex, and we have two local newspapers, and they both regularly report on school news. And those journalists are much more approachable because, again, they're working to tight deadlines and they want stories. So anything local, anything you can tie into local will get you coverage, because the journalists often have good contacts with the local schools. I mean, you've all seen the local newspapers when, you know, the little nursery kids start school, photographs of the new intake and things. It's always of local interest, and that local newspapers, if you're just getting into this, are a good place to start. Specialist trade publications, there's many of those, as we know. For no reason, I've just picked ones with education. Obviously, we're the investor business. TEDS, teach primary and teach secondary are good publications. But there are hundreds, and it just really depends on the niche that these serve. And I'll come on to talking a little bit about writing for these publications and writing for these target publications. Because one of the things we have to be aware of is know your target media. And we'll move on to some of the things around that. And then obviously there's broadcast. And that's not something I'm particularly going to touch on in this presentation, but I have had experience of that. Probably one of the best ways of getting any story out there, if you can get in front of any of these news organisations. The nice thing about these organisations is they don't just break news, but they also report it as well, and they are happy to include expert comment. We've got Pat Mainprice sat there from Education City, and he knows what he's talking about. Pat would be a good person to put up in front of a camera and talk to a reporter. Yes, you would. So, you know, that kind of thing, getting people in front of the camera. That's not something I'll explicitly cover in this, but I will draw some lessons which I think are generally applicable to all media. And then the general interest stuff, and that can be anything really. I mean, that can go from your glossy magazines through to, you know, much smaller publications. Anything where there's a human angle, but it's related to education. So that's really just my quick overview. So some rules, as promised. The first one, and probably most important one, really, is know your target audience. Who are you writing for? Who do you want your information to be read by? Are you supplying to classroom teachers? Are you supplying to network specialists in schools? Are you supplying to senior leadership teams? Who is your audience? And make sure that if you know your target audience, you write for it. There's no point sending a press release to a magazine or to a magazine that represents general classroom teachers like we do, densely explaining how your network solution can improve the lives of network coordinators everywhere. It probably won't make the cut with me because our magazine is a staff room magazine and it's a lighter read than some of the specialist publications with specialist readerships who would be interested in that sort of thing. So if you know your specialist target audience in terms of who your magazines reach, write for them. If they understand the jargon, if they understand what a board is and the difference between a bite and a bit, then that's great. That's something that you can write about because you're talking to an informed audience. Know your target publication is obviously the next thing. Understand who your target publications are and what they represent. Understand their audience and understand how they work. Plan your press campaigns. I'll go into each of these in more detail as we move through the slide. Plan your press campaigns. Yeah, that's planning is something sometimes it can be a problem, particularly if you're doing it yourself. Having the time to think, okay, we need to sit down and we need to think, where is this going? Where is this product story going? Where is this news going? And how do we go about planning that? I'll give you some pointers, the kind of things that I like to see. Obviously, establish good relationships with the journalists you work for. That's obviously a rule, but it's something that I would imagine would be common sense. You would just, you know, you wouldn't actively fall out with journalists if you wanted them to publish your work. I will move on to that because that does happen sometimes. So again, a rule, just establish good relationships. And I'll break that down into how you can be helpful. Respect deadlines. That's, you know, this is something that is really, really important. For anyone who has worked in print or press, deadlines really are the one thing that, you know, gives me grey hair, and I'm only 27, but look at me, deadlines. Yeah, deadlines, I'll come back to deadlines again because they kind of make the whole system work. And brevity is good when you're writing stuff. Keep it short and punchy. And again, we'll unpack a little bit about that. You know, for the most part, the shorter the better, because it'll save journalists time subbing things down. It'll save editors time kicking it back, saying, can we have a shorter version? Can we have less comment? You know, brevity is usually a good thing. If a journalist is interested in your story and wants more, he or she will come back to you for more. Know your target audience. So as I said, we'll just have a quick look. And Those who know me will have heard me say this many, many times, but in the education sphere, for general education, imagine you're speaking to a room full of teachers. I think as far as the target audience bit goes, I could probably leave it at that, because you are writing for an audience of educationalists. You are not normally writing for an audience of specialists. So these people may be specialists in their own field, but they are teachers. And I always say, if it works, if this was a room of classroom teachers and you were standing up and explaining your products, explaining your story, your services, then it would work on paper and in the magazine as well as it would work. And because our audience, my audience, is teachers, if you're writing for teachers and you understand to write for teachers, then you've got a good chance of getting in the magazine, because that's my audience. I'm a conduit in that respect. Your news, your stories go in via me, and my filters are always, imagine you're talking to a room full of teachers. Okay. What do you want your audience to take away from the story? This is something that can often be lost in detail when you're creating a, putting a piece together, talking about a story. You've got to remain focused on the key points, obviously, but what do you want the what do you want the impression to be? What do you want the people who are reading that to take away? Are you selling time saving? Are you selling the benefits of faster school broadband? Are you selling, you know, more up-to-date software? What is it, the key part of what you're writing about, and how does that reflect in the story that you're putting together? So if you ask yourself the question, you'll often be halfway to writing a good piece of product news. And kind of moving on from that, is your piece relevant and engaging? Again, sometimes it's easy to think, I've written a piece of product news, job done, and get that out of the door. But again, ask yourself the question, what does it mean to the people who are reading this? What does it mean? Are they going to think, well, that's interesting, but doesn't have a lot to do with me? Are they going to be engaged by the piece you're writing? And that can go across the whole gamut of whatever you're submitting, from comment pieces, which is something I particularly like in the magazine, again, as Pat will tell you. I like opinion, but what are they taking away? And does it chime? Does it resonate with the audience that you've chosen to address with that piece? So again, analyze your story. Is it suitable for a general audience, the kind of stuff that we publish? Or is it specific? You know, network specialists, modern foreign language teachers, SEND practitioners. You'll know your products well, you'll know your services, but how do you get into under the skin of the story and give it to people who then will read it and understand it? So analyze your story. And if you're promoting a product or service, how is it of benefit or interest to your target audience? So again, bringing it back all the time. Constantly look at your work and think, how is this of benefit to the people I'm talking to? How is this of benefit? What are they going to take away from this? So the key plank is know who you're writing for. And as I say, for me, that first bit really, that's my takeaway from this. It's something that was said to me a long time ago, and I took it on board. And everything that I do in the magazine, the pieces that we write on the editorial side, the pieces that I commission, all have the room full of teachers as my particular watchword. And don't oversell. Allow your audience to decide for themselves. You'll know, you deal with teachers, you deal with schools. You know, there's maybe an element there that don't like being sold to overly, because after all, they're there to teach children. And I think part of the, sometimes press releases can come across, or product news or whatever can come across as a little bit too salesy. Again, I'll touch on that later. But don't oversell, you don't need to. If you've got a good product, then people will come to you. And then know your target publication and media. And these are just basic questions that you would ask me, I think, with the first time you met me. What kind of stories does my target media run? We've gone through the due diligence of the kind of magazines and press media that you would like to target, taking it down a level. What kind of stories do they run? Do they run human interest? Do they like particularly technical stories? Are they interested in teachers' voices? Ask the journalists, ask the people who work for the papers or the magazines or the media generally. Is it news-led? You know, is it an organisation, The Guardian, for example, where it would be news, or a longer-form story is more suitable for maybe the weekend supplements or for, you know, a more detailed feature? So when you're approaching these organisations again, think, just say, okay, are you after news? Can we pitch longer-form stories? And who's your target publication's main audience? Again, going back to what we do, it's just classroom teachers as a rule. We have some specialist sections, but the majority of our teachers are classroom teachers. We are a staff room magazine, as I say. So we're the kind of thing where it's on the table in the staff room or the school office. Teacher will spend 20 minutes, maybe, if they've got 20 minutes, unlikely in some schools. But they'll spend a few minutes flicking through, having a look at the news, picking out little bits of comment, reading our View from the Classroom feature. Or is it an audience of, as I say, network specialists, or does it go to senior leadership team? And what kind of publication is it? As I say, staff room, specialist. Is it free? Our magazine's free. Or is it paid for? Can make a difference. Is it ad-funded? We are, and I'll just touch on that briefly a little bit later on. What's the editorial policy for submissions and pitches? Again, a fairly basic question. But do you accept submissions? Do you accept content submissions, or is it journalist-led? Will a journalist contact me, or can I send you some stuff for publication? What's the editorial line? How does a magazine or a newspaper view the educational landscape generally? Is it supportive of teachers? Guardian springs to mind, tend to be supportive of teachers. Or is it maybe a little less so, and some of the middle-range tabloids spring to mind, horror stories about schools and a standard in education. Again, be aware where your news would be best placed. Is there a features list? That's a fairly specific thing, but a lot of people don't ask. Magazines like ours, and most of the trade magazines in the sector, will have a features list. And if you can get aligned with that features list, and you can find out more about what's thinking behind those features, ours is fairly generic. And it doesn't change much year on year. We've created a fairly generic features list to allow for a wide range of articles beneath it. We have features on pedagogy. We have features on outdoor learning. It's a wide range. Have a look on the website. But they're designed to make the journalist's life a little bit easier, but they're also designed to help the people who submit articles and content. And does it look for expert comment? You know, if you have an expert you can put up, then by all means contact them and say, look, we've got this guy, he's brilliant, he knows all about this XYZ subject, this education issue. A law firm contacted me recently in the wake of the taking kids out of school during term time for holidays. There was a case in the Isle of Wight. A fellow won his case for taking his children out of school during term time. The legal company contacted me and just said, are you looking for some comment on that? And I said, well, actually, yeah, that would be quite interesting. So they had a think about what their speciality were. They had an expert and put him up to me, and I commissioned that piece. So he had a 500-word comment piece in the magazine. So they were lucky because I like comment, and a lot of my magazine is now devoted to comment. I've been running it for about 3 years, and I've gradually turned it into the kind of magazine that I'd like to read, and I know that, you know, teachers like to read. But they'd obviously asked the question. They wouldn't have known if they hadn't rung me or emailed me and said, do you take comment? And if so, we've got this great guy lined up. So some of these questions are very basic, and you'll do this naturally. But I just thought it might be worth putting them down so that you had a kind of an aid memoir when you're going through this. So that's your target media. You know your target audience and you're writing for it. What about how do you go about implementing it? Well, again, decide on your target publications, but be realistic. It's a nice mistake to make. You know, you produce world-leading software for online exams, but is that necessarily something that some of the big players will be interested in reporting on as a news story? Choose your publications with one eye on likelihood of getting published, I think, first and foremost, because it's better to have some news out there, because news gets picked up from lower down and goes up, rather than start at the top and be disappointed. If you try and get hold of Branwyn Jones or whoever at the BBC or whoever the Guardian media editor is, education editor is these days, it might be a thankless job, to be honest. I think you'd be better off being realistic and say, yeah, we have something. If you really believe you have something worthy of the Nationals, then by all means go for it. But just be aware you might need to temper your initial expectations with maybe a little bit of realism. Timeliness. Is my story news or is it less time sensitive? Again, this feeds into the planning process. If you've got something you want to get out there straight away, then that's fine, out it goes. But if you have something a bit more thoughtful, does it have to go today? Does it have to be sent out straight away? Or is it a little bit less time sensitive? I get quite a lot of calls from companies and PR companies asking me about including stuff on the website. And I say, yeah, that's fine. We can put stuff up on the website. But I often ask them back, or is there another angle to that story? Is there something else about what you've just told me that doesn't really mean it has to break now? Can we explore it in a bit more detail? And it's useful if you're thinking the same way. I had a conversation on Friday with a lady. She'd rung me up and said pretty much exactly that. We've got some breaking news about something. And I said, that's great. I can put it on the website. It'll go out on Twitter and that's all good. But it's an interesting story. And if you've got the time, can we make that into something a little bit more interesting than just whatever the news story was at the time? These less time-sensitive stories have a little bit more longevity, if you like. So they tend to stick around a wee bit longer than just the, you know, news today is fish and chips tomorrow kind of thing. The print just disappears. But the less time-sensitive stuff tends to linger a bit longer. And it lingers in people's minds as well. We know when we speak to the teachers who read our magazine that it's the longer form stuff, it's the comment pieces that really stick. And the news stories is fine, but, you know, that's the front of the magazine, essentially. The less time-sensitive stuff works better for us. So then what do you do? Well, obviously, you contact the people at the target organisations, your target publications and media, and you try and find out whether they're actually interested in what you're offering. Now, that can take a number of forms, but don't be afraid to ask advice. Because I think knowing from my experience and from speaking to other journalists in this field, is this the sort of story you publish is a question that doesn't get asked, but is one that should be asked very regularly. Okay, so I'll get people coming to me saying we've got a hot story and they've almost made the assumption that I'm going to run it, but they haven't maybe done the necessary research previously about the target media. That's just a really easy shortcut question. Is this the sort of story you publish? There's only two answers to that, yes or no, or maybe. And then obviously the next question is, well, what kind of stories do you publish then? Or how can we make this fit your policy, your editorial line? And then that becomes a conversation. And then that gives you an idea, a much better idea of the kind of thing that the journalist is looking for. I did mention deadlines, didn't I, earlier? Be aware of deadlines, please. If in doubt, ask. I've got a whole slide on deadlines, because that's one thing that really does give everyone conniptions when it doesn't work. So be aware of deadlines. If in doubt, ask. When do you need this by? And be specific. So you've moved from targeting to actually speaking to journalists. I can't really give you any advice on how to get your foot in the door, because that's just a matter of either perseverance or being lucky. It's like anything in life. You know, you may just happen to be at an event and you meet a journalist, or you may be lucky and he's in his office or she's in his office, picks up the phone when you ring or email. It's just one of those things. But once you're in, these are the kind of things that you should be doing. Yeah, be specific. Be absolutely specific. This story ties in nicely with the news about X. Bearing in mind before that, you know, greenhouses and Brexit maybe don't necessarily sit in the same story. If you've genuinely got something that works well with news about education, and there's always plenty of news about education, let them know about it. Let me know about it. And make sure you're prepared. Once you've done all of this, make sure you're prepared, because if you're lucky, you may need to move quickly if your story's picked up. You might get a call back. Are you ready? You know, journalists will say, right, we'd like to get someone in to talk to you. I'd like to come and see you. So have something ready that you can send to follow up. So if you've planned and you're prepared, you know what you're going to say, you know some of the questions you're going to ask, you've established your levels of interest, you've decided on the actual form of the story and how important it is that it goes out now or later, and you've decided on your target publication. It's not a template, and every press campaign will be different, but I think there's some questions there that you could maybe use the next time you're calling someone with a piece that you're putting up. So working with journalists, get to know them. That's the easiest thing, really, just talk to them. Get to know the people who work for your target publications. Find out what interests them. My particular hot buttons, parental engagement, because I'm a parent myself, so I think parental engagement in schools is very important. as a trinity of child, teacher, parent, and that when those three are working together well, the child does well at school. Also, collaboration is something that interests me very much between teachers. So, this is a conversation we'd have if you were talking to me on the phone, you'd ring me up and said, what kind of stories are you running? And then, you'll find a much more receptive audience, as in all things in life, if you're helpful and open. And that can go across the board, that if you're, again, we'll get back to deadlines. But if a journalist rings you up and asks you for something, make sure that you help them. Understand what the journalist is looking for, and this is an opportunity, really, to help shape the angle, if it helps a journalist, because like a lot of people today, everyone's busy, and sometimes an angle of a story is not immediately apparent at first blush. If I read something, I sit there and I think, okay, well, that's a product piece, so that's not necessarily going to make anything out of this for my magazine. But if the savvy person who sent me that said, actually, well, it is a product piece, but there's a reason why. There's an angle here. We can boost outcomes for disadvantaged kids or for BME or whatever. There's always an angle somewhere. And if you're thinking about that when you're writing the story and you're thinking about it when you're working with the journalist, again, you're helping them. You're being helpful. And it saves me a lot of time wondering what the angle is in the story and how to be polite about saying, actually, sorry, I can't use it. So understand what the journalist is looking for. And you can only do that by talking. Find out how they work. It's just a little thing, but some people prefer emails over phone calls and some people prefer it the other way around. So that's a really easy question. Do you mind if I email you? Would you rather I call you? It's just something that it makes me more disposed to the people who are talking to me initially. If I haven't had contact from them before, if they ask me, I don't mind either way. I'll say that now. You can email me, you can call me. But some people do prefer to work by email because either they're out of the office a lot and they can, they've been busy and again, they lose messages and things. And find out more about the sorts of stories they work on. We're a general magazine. I am the journalist. I am the complete journalist resource for the magazine. So I work on all kinds of stories. But in the larger titles and in the larger nationals and in the dailies, there'll be specific areas that these people work on. So find out the kind of stories they work on. And if that fits with where you want to be and where you want your story to be, then go for it. Deadlines. I did mention deadlines. Yeah. Find out what they are. And then make sure you meet them, because they're there for a reason. It's less important, I'll be honest, in monthly titles like ours, because there's always a little bit of flexibility. But if you're writing copy for the Daily Mail, or you're a journalist, an education journalist that's producing copy for dailies, it's very, very important that that story runs when they say it's going to run. It's all common sense stuff. If you have doubts about hitting the deadline, don't let them know 2 hours before the deadline expires, please. It's fine, but really, if you think it's not coming together, explain why. Don't overpromise. That's always the way. And then fail to deliver. I can send you 1,500 words on this topic and you end up getting 400 and a tiny little picture, again. Find out if these deadlines are negotiable. As I say, they often are. Or if there's an opportunity for inclusion in a later issue or programme. So maybe we can't hit that deadline, but could we get in the next one? Again, just a question you might want to think about. Anyway, missing one deadline is not the end of the world, but miss two or three and people will stop talking to you because you become marked in the book as unreliable, and nobody wants to be unreliable because everyone's doing their job, we're all busy, and it's a shame if a good story or a good piece of work gets missed because you haven't had a good track record. So deadlines, it's just one of those things, and you've got to be aware that journalists do work today. I know you are aware of that, but they are very important to most journalists. And that's the 4 o'clock in the morning waking up going, God, we've got to get that out today or else we're in trouble. Some practical pointers. Prepare. Now this, again, I said I wasn't really talking about face-to-face or broadcast. I came from a meeting this morning in London Bridge with a PR lady and her client. And it was obvious that the client had prepared carefully before we met. The PR lady had brokered the meeting, but it was very much his meeting and he had prepared carefully what he wanted to say. He was consistent and coherent. He hadn't, as far as I could tell, done it on the tube on the way to the meeting. If you have a consistent story and message, then preparation will make sure that what you want to say comes across well. It's too easy. I mean, we all know that in you know, this sector is not necessarily looking to make anyone look stupid. I've never tried to pick holes in people's pieces, or you know, I've never tried to get a scoop because people have misspoken in an interview. But you know, there are journalists who will try and trick people. Andrea Leadsom springs to mind recently about the mums thing. Now that was an off-the-cuff remark. We all heard the audio of that, the Telegraph reporter had done. And that became the focus of the piece. It wasn't about Andrea Leadsom's suitability to be PM. It wasn't about her suitability to do any other job. She thought that mums, the fact she was a mum, was better, made her a better candidate than Theresa May. So be prepared. You know, she, with her time again, she would never have said that, obviously, because that derailed a campaign. So be prepared. And be clear when you're talking to a journalist. Don't get bogged down in jargon, unless they're expecting it, unless it's that kind of piece. Again, going back to your niche markets, to your niche publications. But normally clarity is a good thing. It's a little bit like your elevator pitch. You don't have a massive amount of time to get your story across or get your point of view across if you're looking to place a comment. So don't get too bogged down in a lot of the jargon and the acronyms that float around education. Teachers love acronyms, I know. My sister's one. She's a Spock. Spock. Anyone? Single point of contact. So she works with behavior, children with behavioral difficulties, and she coordinates all the agencies that impact on that child, police, health, social services. And the first time she told me she was a Spock, my reaction was pretty similar to yours. Right? Okay. A journalist might, you know, not know that either. So be clear. Now, as I say, jargon is fine where it serves a purpose, and if the audience is expecting it, if the journalist is expecting it, then absolutely fine. But as a rule, if you're doing general stuff, yeah, be brief. Again, linked to clarity, but you know, introduce it. Introduce what you do concisely. It's too easy to get bogged down in detail, and often you don't need to, because again, as long as you hook interest, it's like talking to anyone. If someone's interested in what you've got to say, they will ask more questions. This morning, again, case in point, the fella spent, I guess, about 3 minutes explaining the company and what they did. And it was sufficiently interesting. It was quite an interesting concept. They're a Swedish company, actually, but looking to break into the UK. It got us talking. It became a conversation. And it didn't feel forced, either. Sometimes, you know, I turn up to do interviews with people, and it can be a little bit hard work because either there's an enormous amount of waffle goes on before we actually get down to the question bit, or there isn't really a rapport, but we'll get on to that. But, yeah, be brief. Just be concise. You don't need to over-egg it at that point. You explain your key points and then sit back and let the journalist do the work for half an hour. Be responsive, again, being helpful and open, as I said a little bit ago. If a journalist calls for a comment, yeah, make sure you get back to them, or at least let them know why you can't. There's nothing wrong with being unable to supply a comment, but just, you know, as a courtesy, just say, well, actually, we can't get back to you. Then that won't put you on that unreliable list. Oh, they never got back to me. Actually, they did get back to you. They just said they couldn't do anything at that particular point. Yeah, and get to the point again. If you're discussing a story, make sure that I understand what it is you want me to take away from what you're telling me. And there's nothing wrong with actually saying, oh, and if you take one thing away from this, this is the thing that I'd like you to take away. Because again, you're helping me. Because if I sit and look at a press pack, there's lots of information in there. But what is it? What do you really want me to take away from this? So have a look at a few more images. Now, this is pretty much for the print, but make sure you've got some nice images. I lose count of the amount of times I have to say, please, can you send me some high-res images for the print magazine? And I know it's a small thing, and you know, you maybe don't deal with print, or you deal with online only, but if you're dealing with print with the press, have a nice library of images, or at least have some images that we can use with the story, because, you know, a nice picture brightens up a page beautifully. And especially in the kind of magazines that I work with, they're all full of pictures. Yeah, control the conversation. Again, going back to what do you want the journalist to take away from it? you know, you're in a good position because you're explaining something about your company or your product or services that the journalists won't necessarily understand, and you have the chance to control that conversation. You have the chance to get your point across and to direct where you want that conversation to go. It's not in a manipulative way. It's not in a sort of controlling way necessarily. It's more just for your benefit, so that you know that your point has been made clearly, and that there are areas that are irrelevant to the discussion that you may get talking about later on, but always bring it back to what you want to talk about. Yeah, and share your knowledge, you know, share freely, because there's a good chance that about 60% of what you say, 50 to 60% of what you say, probably won't make it into the finished product. And that's kind of the rule I work with is when I'm putting pieces together. I won't take verbatim. I do sometimes do verbatim interviews, but for the most part, a lot of the stuff that we talk about doesn't get into the magazine. So you're not showing the crown jewels to your competitors, let's say, but it does inform the way the article goes together. I'll give you an example. I was speaking to a company about 3 weeks ago, and we were talking, it's someone I know quite well, and he said, look, there's a reason why this works like it works, and he explained to me the reasons and said, but you know, I'm telling you that to give you the picture, but it would be great if that didn't make it into the finished article because it's not necessarily something we really want to publicize. It wasn't a bad thing, but it was a more technical detail. And I said, that's fine. It helped me understand the story. It helped me understand what it was that they were doing and why this was a good thing. But there was no need to include the detail in what I was writing, but he had shared his knowledge with me. And you know, I appreciated the fact that he told me it, and it did help crystallize some things in my mind about what he was talking about. So you're the expert, and that again goes back to this bit, about controlling the conversation. The journalist is there presumably either because he's had this meeting set up or because he's interested, or he or she is interested in what you want to talk about. So you're the expert, so you have the ability to shape that conversation and to, you know, wow the journalist maybe with expert knowledge, to show that you are in control of your subject. Make sure that the people that you do contact understand why they're getting the story. So that goes back to what I said before about this ties in nicely with news about X or Y. Sometimes it can be a little bit strange. I've got some examples coming up as well, just for a bit of fun, of stuff that I received yesterday, 3 emails that either fully address or don't address any of these, or bits in between. And I thought, when we get to them, and I'll take some suggestions from the floor about what went well, what didn't go so well with it, so that you can see, I get lots of press releases, and I'm not quite sure what people want from me when I receive it. I mean, I understand they want to get it published, but I'm not quite sure what it, you know, we'll move on, but you'll see what I mean in a little bit. And remember, you have a limited window, time window, to ensure your story is noticed or read. Because, you know, we're busy. I get, I don't know, 300 emails a day or something. And they're not all telling me that I've, you know, won the lottery. Make the most of it. So be punchy about what you send. Right, here's some examples. Now, I've blacked this out. This will tell you, first of all, this is not the greatest example in the world. So that I don't cause anyone any hardship, I've kind of made this, blacked out the bits who it was from and the subject matter and... But this is an email that I received yesterday. I promise, this is true. Something, something are perfect for schools. 2 attachments. Hello, hope this is of interest. The photo shows the back. Best wishes, back. Now, what I said before about having a limited window of opportunity to make a case, what do we think? What's going wrong there? The next slide, I have some thoughts, my thoughts on it, and the reason why I sort of I actually laughed when I got that, not out of being mean, but I just thought, I'm actually putting a slideshow together about talking to the press, and I got that, so, yes.
You have to do the work.
Yeah.
You have to go and do the research,
yeah.
Find out what it is.
There was that. I'll say I hadn't met this person or been introduced to this person before either.
Is this not even a paragraph about the product?
Precisely. Anything else?
When you use a word like perfect, you have to provide some evidence, you need clear, you know, concise evidence.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. There's even a... Sorry, go on, yeah.
So they haven't even addressed it to you.
that's the other thing, yeah. I'm not, you know, that sometimes I'm prissy about it and sometimes I'm not. I mean, my name's Jonathan and it can be spelt a number of different ways according to everyone in the world apart from my mum and dad who spelt it one way. Yeah, that's definitely one thing.
I suppose perfect doesn't really mean anything as well, because you're not relating it.
Exactly right, yeah, there's that. Let's have a look. Yeah, well, it's received from someone I haven't met, first of all, as I say. So that's not necessarily a bad thing, because you've got to start somewhere. But I think if you are going to send an email to someone for the first time, then I think you should possibly be introducing yourself, even if it's only, hi, I'm so-and-so. Hi, Jonathan, I'm so-and-so from so-and-so. I think that's, you know, a nice way to start. It's something I'd do if I sent an email to someone that I hadn't dealt with previously. It's impersonal, as you say, hello. Which is friendly enough. And as I say, it depends on the weather, whether I take offence at not being, you know. But I think, you know, it's nice if you can get the name in there. So, you know, people think, actually, yeah, you are talking to me. And not just sending it out to a mail merge. The headline, as Pat said, and yeah, a bald statement of fact, blank, blank, are perfect for schools. Really? Okay, let's think about that. Yeah, the email body text, again, there's no mention of what the story is. It tells you what the picture is, but it doesn't tell you anything about the story. There are attachments, but no email body copy. And that's a little thing that annoys me. And you know, it may not annoy other people, but it annoys me. I have to physically click on those attachments to find out anything about what that story is about. And when I'm in the middle of a presentation, when I'm preparing a presentation, and I'm busy, it's 5 minutes or 2 minutes or, you know, 30 seconds. It makes me sound a horrible person. But they're not giving themselves the opportunity to get their story across. So why should I even open those attachments, given all of the above things? You know, what is it about that email that makes you think, wow, I've really got to open that? And again, it's not my lottery winning numbers, so, you know. Maybe a great story, but it absolutely relies on me being willing to open the attachments to find out what it is. So, you know, going back, it's not to say that I would never open an email like that. I don't want to give the impression that, you know, I'm so process-bound and rigid that I will never open an email if you're in a hurry and you send something like that. But I think you can do yourself a lot of favours if you don't send emails like that to people. Because, again, it's making it difficult for me to even get to what that story is about. Now, the headline did say what the story was about, but only in the vaguest terms. And then, yeah, there was nothing. Body text. We'll get back onto this. So I'll show you another one. And this is a bit of a teacher's pet one. And I've left his name in, contrasting bad and, you know, obviously good. It's from a guy called Neil Walton. I've never met Neil before in my life. But he obviously has done a bit of research. And he's looked at this and said, yeah, okay, well, this story fits with your publication. So again, have a quick look if you can see it. And this genuinely came in 5 minutes after that other one. I am not making that up. So what we've got here is quick introduction, bit of body text telling me about the story, an attachment, but he tells me what it is. It's a picture. It's 847K, so that's nice and high res, so that'll do nicely for the magazine. Blah, blah, and offer a help. So, what did Neil get right? Well, it's relevant. I read his little intro para and I thought, yeah, absolutely, that fits with my magazine. Absolutely fits right. Now, maybe he's got lucky and just sent that out to 120 educational journalists, and it just so happens he's found one magazine that that's relevant for. Suggests to me he didn't because of the care he took in writing the introduction. It's personalised, he's bothered to use my name, so at least he's found out who I am. It's concise, he gets to the point quickly. Hi, Jonathan, it's Neil from XYZ. It's clear what the story is about, because he's put it in there, where it comes from, the school and him, and where he'd like it published online, as he mentions at the bottom, could you publish this on your website? So he's told me what it's about and he's asked the question. And you know, the asking the question thing, always ask the question, can you put this on your website? If you don't, if you just hope people will do things like that, then they probably won't. So be brave, be bold, ask the question. And it's helpful. He's offered further assistance. I know, again, we all do that in emails, if I can be of any further assistance, but I think, you know, even just to put the offer in there helps and makes me more kindly disposed towards him, if that doesn't sound too pompous. Obviously, in the high-res image attached. So I think, you know, going back to that one, that's an example of something that I smiled when I read it because I thought, yeah, well, that's my next example then, as I was at that point in the presentation. But, you know, he's introduced his agency that he works for, Deep South, and he's introduced the school. He's briefly put a synopsis in. As far as the body text was concerned, the whole story was in there. So if I was interested, I've read the preamble, I've read the preface and his introduction, I can then just scroll straight down and go, yeah, okay, that's interesting, pick out the bits that I was interested in. So I'm going to get back to him to find out a bit more about that. Because one of the features that I run is called View from the Classroom. And it pretty much is what it says it is. It's the view from the teacher's desk. We go in behind the school gates every month to a chosen school, and we talk to teachers about the challenges they face, how technology or different ways of thinking about pedagogy can help in their schools. And it's open to everyone. And it's something I would suggest that you maybe think about if you have schools on board. You might be interested in talking to those schools. It's like an extended case study. It's a nice way for suppliers to get in front of teachers without overly selling, because it explains all of the benefits. It benefits from, you know, peer-to-peer advocacy, teacher advocacy, or whatever they say, given that teachers buy from teachers, supposedly. We'll talk about View from the Classroom later. But, yeah, he has done as much as he needs to get that in front of me and to make me think, yeah, okay, there's something there. The fact it's about a school and they're showing achievement in certain areas then makes me think I might be able to do something more with that. Now, he probably hadn't thought of that when he sent it to me, but he started a conversation, he started a train of thought in my mind, so he's done his job now. I'll get back to him and I'll say, yeah, have you thought about maybe, you know, we maybe won't run that as online news, but I'll tell you what I would be interested in. So he seems to have got under the skin of the mag quite quickly. So, yeah. Final example, again, it's a wee bit pale. This is from Laura Beveridge at Bloomsbury, and it's a book, Creative Approach to Teaching Spelling. The what, why, and how of teaching spelling, starting with phonics. This, having shown the bad and the good, for me falls maybe somewhere in between. What works and what doesn't about that? She breaks some of the rules, my personal rules. Obviously, it's gone out to a list, and it's not gone straight to me. But I don't mind, because I know Laura anyway. I know of her. I know Bloomsbury. There are some good things in there. It's clear. It's obviously a book, which is a good thing. That's a good place to start. You don't need to set the proposition, this is what we're about, because obviously it's Bloomsbury and it's a book. Benefits, if you read the email, it articulates what my readers will take away from the book. So that's good, because I then think, okay, that's relevant and interesting for my readers. The author's credentials are explained. In this particular case, it's important because a lot of education books rely on credibility. Whether ex-teachers or, you know, teachers like to read books by teachers explaining about how things work and how to improve classroom performance and pedagogy. So that's good. It's impersonal, as I say, but that's okay in that case, because, you know, I know of her and I know the company well. But there's a few buts here, and this comes back to something I said before. What does she want from me? She never makes it explicit in the email. Is she asking for a review of the book? Or hoping I'll include it as news? Does she know that Education Today doesn't do book reviews? You know, what is it that she wants? Have they researched fully whether I include reviews or do product announcements like that? So she's kind of got halfway there in my mind. We've seen the bad practice, if you like. We've seen the good practice, and this is somewhere in between. And these were three emails from yesterday. And I just thought I'd pick them out because I thought, you know, they do show that's your limited window. If you've never met someone before, that's your opportunity to get in front of them. Maybe take some of that away. But this leads me on to what I was talking about a little bit earlier about advertising. And I think this is a good point to maybe just open this can of worms for 5 minutes. You decide how you want to present your piece. That's fine. You make the decision about how this piece comes across. You put as much product detail in or not as you wish, knowing who you're sending this to. You think you know the editorial rules of the publication you've targeted or the media you've targeted and whether advertising is offered. Most of the trade magazines will offer advertising and will take advertising. But this is, for me, the most important thing. Be honest with yourself. When you put the piece together, a new module comes out for a piece of software, or we've upgraded our classroom furniture now so it conforms fully with ES, blah, blah, blah standards. Is it really editorial? Or would it work better as paid for? Now, I'm not selling the mag at all here. I keep saying that. I'm the editor. I have colleagues who do that sort of thing. But would it work better as a piece of paid for content? And there are so many opportunities there. If you know, 150, 200 quid, 250 quid, would that be money better spent on advertising that story and putting it in as is, exactly as you wrote it, exactly as you wanted it to be presented, without anyone else's influence at all. Doesn't mean I go in and sub-edit the last four paragraphs out and all the great quotes you spent a week and a half chasing down from your MD or whoever else, and that all gets stripped out and you end up with a two-paragraph piece of news on page seven. You can put your whole proposition into a piece of advertising, and all of those trade magazines, ours and Investor and many others, will take advertorial and will take advertising. And it might sometimes be worth asking that you, when you get to the point where you're about to launch on this and go through the sometimes thankless task of getting people interested in your story, maybe I could just shortcut circuit this whole thing. And maybe I just think, actually, you know what, for 150 quid, I'll put a quarter page in the magazine. So it's not meant to be a call to advertise. It's not meant to be anything other than a bit of honest advice. Be honest with yourselves when you're reading it. Does it read like an advert? And if it does, it probably should be an advert. Yeah. The art of the press release. People write books on this stuff, don't they? I've seen many books about how to write and craft the perfect press release. I'm not sure there are any rules, to be honest, but there's some things that I look out for. Yeah, right. Can we all just take note of that, please? I've got a 12-year-old daughter. Just don't get me started on spelling and grammar. But yeah, for the education press, it's got to be spelled correctly and the grammar needs to be good, I think.
House rules. Again, this is because you know who you're talking to. This is this kind of nuts and bolts stuff for most of you, I imagine. But try to adhere to the house rules where possible. So if I don't have caps in my headlines, and this is all freely available, and it's a small point, but if you send me all caps, headlines and stuff,
that means I have to spend 2 minutes subbing it and recasting it so that it goes to design in the correct layout, or sub-editor has to. It's just a little bit less work for everyone, and it, again, makes people more kindly disposed the next time they get a release. Headlines. Yeah, shorter is always better in headlines than longer, always. So yeah, it might be true that this, you know, world-beating product, blah, 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 wins 6 awards at annual conference for blah, 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 and you know, that may well be true. But shorter's better, because again, it's the headline that grabs the attention. And that works just as well for me as it does for my readers. Again, a long headline requires work sometimes to get it down. And it's a work of minutes, but over a whole magazine, it can become a chore. Obviously, you need to be informative. So if you genuinely can't help writing a long headline, sure, write a long headline, but it's there for a reason. It's not just a big headline, which is a kind of first paragraph. Length. Shorter is better, again, so back to brevity. Shorter is better, because you might feel that there are 15 important things about your product or your service that need to be included in the press release. But I can almost guarantee you that I'll read the first 2 paragraphs and decide from then on whether it's important or not. And you've wasted a ton of time at the bottom of that, putting all the important stuff in. Either just bang it in as bullet points, or just keep it short. Most of the time, I say. It's not a hard and fast rule. And you'll know, probably, when you've done it a few times, where it works and where it doesn't. There are some things that you just cannot write in a short form. And I commission long-form articles as well. And I do accept pitches, and I do accept, you know, cold contributions, essentially. So if you have a long-form article and you send it to me, that's great, and I will read it, and if it's worthy, it's good to be published, I will publish it. But again, shorter is better as a rule, certainly for news releases. Because you will only have a certain amount of space on the page. I mean, we normally run 4 or 5 news items together on a page, and that's about 250 words. So there's some key information you need to put in there as well, obviously, but contact details, I won't patronise you with the, you know, put your contact details in there, make sure people know how to get hold of you. Some magazines don't run contact details, some do, we do, but only in the news sections as a URL normally. We don't tend to put phone numbers and stuff in. It's the URL, and then the people reading it can decide whether to click on that or not. So shorter is better, in my opinion, and for our magazine, and for most of the trade magazines, I would have thought. Yeah, imagery, again, we're back to that. But again, always include images, because, you know, we like to read magazines with lots of nice pictures in, and particularly for the general or the trade, a picture is a handy shortcut to whatever it is you're selling. If that's a classroom of happy children, or people shaking hands on a deal, whatever it is, then make sure you include some good images. Yeah, content. Again, so going right back to the top, make sure it's aligned to the editorial policy of your target media and that it speaks to your target audience. So you've decided way back at the beginning who you want to talk to in terms of the press. You've got your editorial policy. You know the kind of stuff they commission, and you know your target audience. So it's kind of always apply those filters to whatever you write, to whatever you send, because if you apply those filters to what you send, you are much more likely to have that piece go through the to pass muster on the first pass, if you like. Yeah, and don't allow it to become overly salesy. Again, I know that there's pressures on companies to sell, to make sure that, you know, they're successful companies. But there is no need, maybe in a press release necessarily, to become overly salesy. That's something that can happen when you have conversations with clients and customers. Explain your proposition, explain what it is you're selling, by all means. But don't push too much on that. Because again, there's every chance that your editor will turn around and say, that should be advertising, because it's just too salesy. I mean, we've all, I imagine, had experience of stuff being knocked back because it's been salesy. I used to work on the other side of this. I used to do a lot of PR stuff for people. And one of the art forms was making it salesy without making it salesy. So it's one of those things. It's a little bit try it and see. You know when you get it right, because people will call you back and go, that's interesting. If people never call you back, you'll know that you maybe need to do a bit of work on it. And yeah, back up assertions with credible testimony, what Pat said about the headline, you know, and the lady there said about being perfect for schools. Well, there was nobody told me they were perfect for schools. So I didn't know why they were perfect for schools. So anything you say in your press, make sure that you've got case studies or people who can talk about it. You know, you've got a school who uses your software, put a teacher up. Greatest thing that we've used for years. It's saved me 20 minutes every hour. Learning ladders, for example, you know, suddenly I can assess my children so much better than in the old days of levels. Whatever it is, you need, you know, there's always a human voice in there. So back it up with credible testimony. I mean, that's just a very short list. All I was going to say is spelling and grammar, and make sure that what you're sending is relevant to who you're sending it to. And if that means writing it three times for three different audiences, well, write it three times for three different audiences, or write it carefully so that it can be used for those three different audiences. Don't exclude audiences by including stuff that they don't need to hear or read. So moving on, doing it yourself. Lots of companies now do their own PR. Lots of companies now engage with the press on their own without any medium, such as PR companies. And I thought I'd maybe just highlight some of the good reasons why you could be doing it yourself if you aren't already. You have complete control over everything. There's no one getting in the way of you and your message. You speak to the journalists. You decide what it is that goes in. You tell them. You don't listen to anyone. You know better. And often you do. Because you're the expert. Because what you do as a company, and you work and you live and you breathe your products, you live and breathe your company, no one understands your company or your products like you do. So there's reasons why. You get to choose who to talk to. A lot of PR companies will talk to many different journalists. You can be absolutely specific and say, no, actually, you know what, I'm only going to talk to two people. One because I met him and he was a decent fella, and the other one because I'd really like to get to know him a bit better. So I pick my list and I just go for it. It's free. All you're investing is time and a salary, maybe, of a PR person, but that's okay, because that's a salary. You can also respond quickly as well. Someone rings you up, you can be off the cuff straight away. Say, oh, hello, Pat, it's Jonathan. Oh, hi, Jonathan, blank. Straight into it. You don't have to go through any kind of brokers. And you decide how you drive the news. You decide exactly, you know what's best for your company. You know what's best to do. So you decide how the news is presented. Some of the not-so-good stuff, obviously, and, you know, we mentioned time. It can be a very time-consuming process, this. And I'm particularly thinking about establishing contacts. It's a pain, frankly. If you don't know a load of journalists and you haven't been hanging around in a room with a load of education journalists, then it is a bit of a slog. And I can't honestly offer you any shortcuts to getting around that. I can help you once you're in the door, and I'm more than happy to offer advice about how to get in the door, but ultimately it comes down to phone calls and emails, and probably phone calls first. So be prepared to invest significant time. And then not just in getting your foot in the door, but then also in working on what you're doing, on your press releases, on the product stuff, or the news announcements. Because it is time consuming. And if you're a smallish company, if there's two or three of you or four or five of you, and you've all got busy jobs and you're doing the day job, this can often become a real drain, frankly. I've seen it happen in a lot of companies where people have said, well, I can do that. And yeah, you can, but, you know, right, are you sure, really, you want to be doing that? Is that the best use of your time in your company? And this is not a, by any means, not a recruitment flag for PR. All I'm saying is there are some things to think about when you are looking at doing prep. Are you sure you want to be doing the writing? Because when you read a good press release, you think that looks really easy. When you actually write one and you sit down, you think, right, where do I start? Now, I do everything. As I say, I've done this for a few years. I've done it. I always think of a narrative. I always think of a story. If you start at the beginning, there's a middle and there's an end. And if you can do it in three paragraphs, well done you. But a lot of people struggle to get that done in any kind of reasonable amount of time that allows them to do anything else that day apart from sweat and worry about a press release. Yeah. Some people are great at it, some people aren't. You know, I won't say writing's a gift, it's something you can learn, but some people are naturally just better at writing that kind of thing than others. It's just one of those things. So are you sure you want to be doing writing rather than whatever else you're doing? Consistency, both in voice, so the kind of thing that if you send five or six press releases out, you need to have a consistent tone and a consistent position. And this applies equally well when you're selling products. It needs to, if I get press releases from companies, I like to know that the voice is consistent. So again, it's something that I can pretty much just lift and put straight into a magazine, and certainly in the trade sector, without too much work. So finding a consistent tone and a consistent voice kind of feeds into the writing process. But it is important, and people who read your pieces will soon realize if it's all over the place. So be consistent. If you're going to do it, be consistent. But it is quite hard to get consistency. And really, I think that comes either with natural flair or with practice. And again, it's something you can do. You know, you can learn this stuff. You can practice how to do this, and you get better at it over time. But again, do you really want to be getting better at something over time if you don't need to? Building contacts, where to start? You know, again, how would you go about it? Would you just kind of do a mass mail out? Would you ring people up? It can be a bit daunting. I mean, years ago, I used to be a salesperson, and, you know, that's part of a salesperson's job is to ring people up who don't necessarily want to talk to you and sell them stuff that maybe they didn't know they were interested in. So it's always that kind of deep breath before you pick up the phone. Don't obsess about it too much, though, because, you know, most likely you'll get voicemail, so you can leave a message. But still, it can be a bit tricky getting a decent address book up and running quickly. Yeah, standing out from the crowd, which sort of feeds into that. How do you make sure you get a fair hearing? You know, there's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of companies. Now, as members of BESA, you have BESA batting for you, so that's good. And BESA has a good relationship with the press. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of stuff that BESA does that takes a kind of weight off the members. And I think Patrick Hayes and I have sort of kicked this off with the view that, you know, Education Today is a member of BESA, and as a member, we like to give stuff back to BESA. And one of the things we do is BESA Corner every month, which features two member companies. And that helps you get into the press. Now, that maybe helps you stand out from the crowd, but if you're doing that off your own bat, it can be quite difficult. So I'd suggest maybe you've got a bit of a leg up being part of this organisation in the first place. Personalities. This is something that, it sounds fairly trivial. You may just dislike the journalists that you deal with on a day-to-day basis, but I can tell you, I was at an awards dinner a couple of years back, and someone had to be physically restrained from marching over after a couple of glasses of wine and planting a smack right in the face of one of the journalists who was there. This person had to be physically restrained because this journalist had written something that this person had taken massive exception to. Now, it's not the vast run, 99% of the time you will be fine and, you know, everyone just gets along just fine because we're all doing our jobs. But just be aware that occasionally you'll come across someone who you just don't like. And it works both ways. You know, journalists can also find people that they just don't like to deal with. And that can be a problem if you're doing it on your own. Okay, so if anyone wants to use a PR company, we know what they do. They exist to promote your company's products and services. I find them helpful. I think it's true to say that some journalists have a bit of a snobby view of PR companies, viewing it as, you know, the dark side, and that journalists who couldn't hack it in journalism ended up doing PR. it's not a majority view, but some journalists just do take that view, and it's unfortunate because certainly from my personal experience, I work with 5 or 6 excellent PR companies, I've got to say, who help me out at short notice, who have some great contacts and stories, and we'll go through a little bit more about that. But good PR companies will have a helpful source of stories. They've got excellent contacts, obviously, because that's what they're there for, is to make sure that your news goes out to the right people. Completely bypasses and short-circuits any of that legwork that you might feel like you have to do yourself. I say often able to provide copy on short notice. We'll have a look at when that fails, but generally, PR company will be able to provide a journalist with something pretty quickly. Having said what I said before about when you're doing it yourself, you're able to be off the cuff with a journalist. That's a good thing, but most good PRs are able to do this pretty quickly. So journalists, certainly in trade, magazines, and in lifestyle and things, will rely on PR companies quite a lot. They understand your target audience, or at least they should, and if you think about this as a checklist, if you ever do go and retain one, they know who you're speaking to, they should do. They'll know, in our case, it's education. I mean, the PR companies that work with education today understand that we are a classroom magazine, and they will create PR that is suitable for that audience. Again, it's what you would be doing if you were doing it yourself. They're just taking that bit out of it. They also, of course, because they have excellent contacts, understand the various editorial lines and policies of the main magazines, business newspapers, whatever, main media in the sector. So they know that I don't like all caps headlines, for example, or they know that I'm very supportive of classroom teachers. They know that I'm like that. So they will send me stuff that is supportive of classroom teachers. They write coherent press releases. So going back to that tone of voice, a PR company sends me stuff, it reads coherently, it has a consistent message of voice, and it's aimed at the target audience again. So, and they're accountable. So that if it doesn't work out, they should be able to demonstrate success. If they don't, then use someone else. Feel free to shop around. So that's some reasons why you might consider using a PR company. I mean, I come down sometimes on the side of doing it yourself. I mean, I've run courses where I've taught people, like, say, how to write press releases and how to put pieces together. And there's a lot of people who are able just to do it without PR companies. But I think the most important takeaway is really this bit, the contacts. It really does save you a lot of time because your news can go out to the right people at the right time. And there's no waste of your time or effort sending it to people who aren't interested in what you've got to say. You speak to someone like Sue Murray at Mango or Livewire, whoever. They'll pretty quickly get to understand who it is that you want to talk to, and they will be able to provide you a list of journalists that they will then put up in front of you. And it frees your time up to spend on the day job, effectively. So you're not head down writing stuff that you don't need to be writing when you should be doing more important things, if you're not a dedicated person who's doing that in the company anyway. If that's the case, you have quite a lot of input into what PR goes out anyway, and you work with the PR company, and it can suddenly make your job as a PR exec in a company a lot more interesting working with a third-party PR company. And I've seen that happen quite a lot. A friend of mine worked for a company, and she was their in-house PR person, and was doing a good job, but then they decided to take on an external PR agency, and she was worrying about her position because she thought, well, now we've got these glamorous people suddenly, you know, sending stories out everywhere, what the hell am I meant to be doing? But she actually found that her job flourished because she was, if you like, the expert, the in-house expert that the PRs came to talk to about the products that this company produced. And she found a much more rewarding job working, and eventually ended up working for these things. That was a by the by, but she found it wasn't as threatening a move as perhaps she first thought. Some other thoughts on PR. Well, there's always a cost, obviously. That's probably the main thing. That's probably the main reason if you're a smallish business, you would probably think, okay, can I afford it? And that's something you have to discuss with the agency if you decide to go down the route. There are many different ways they charge, but you will be paying for it. So that's something you obviously have to bear in mind. Remember what I said about you're the expert? Well, they're not, as a rule. They're good in the sector. They know the people in the sector. They understand what's going on in the sector. But they certainly will not know as much about your product as you do. So again, balance off the good things you get with some of the things that are maybe less good about retaining PR. This is often the case, and it's something that I think, having said all the good stuff about providing short notice copy, it's still an iterative process drafting PR. If you're the two of you, if there's a third party company and yourself working together, it's very much an iterative process. You'll get the first draft back, you have to sign that off. You get the second draft back, you make corrections. It does go on a bit. So for some of the shorter timeline stuff, some of the stuff that you want to get out pretty quickly, there can occasionally be holdups. I've mentioned deadlines, haven't I? They can be missed. This happened to me 2 weeks ago. PR and the client didn't communicate effectively. They just weren't talking to each other properly. And I had a hard deadline, and it meant that their client missed out because, now that's them getting kicked all over the place because they failed to do the job properly. But just when you're talking to these people, make sure that they have good lines of communication with clients. How often do I get an update? How regularly do we have client meetings? How quickly do you need things turned around if you get a call for copy? Just questions again you can ask. And finally, PRs, well, they might represent a number of companies similar to your own. How special do you want to feel? If there are five companies out there producing whiteboards, and you're just one of five, you might feel like just one of five. You might feel that you can do better writing it for yourself because you know your company. So that was, I say, some thoughts on why you might retain a PR if you realise that actually this is all getting a bit too much for me doing it myself. And also why you may have second thoughts, or at least think about it. So just to tie it all together, I think, yeah, we're journalists are people, guys. Relationships are key. Get to know the people that you're working with. Get to know the people who write. And so I know a few faces around the room. It's always nice to see them. Trade shows are good places to meet journalists. Any bar after about midnight is usually a good place. No, it's not really. Just get to know them. And by asking some simple questions, as we did back up, further up in the presentation, that should give you at least some kind of idea of what motivates and what they're interested in. If you can key into people's interests, you will find a more sympathetic hearing, I think. Going back again, define your target audience. Yes, so you know who you want to speak to, so make sure you write to that. And ensure that whoever you're speaking to in the press speaks to that audience as well. Spend some time understanding what we as journalists are looking for. Are we looking to break news? Are we looking for longer form stuff? What do we as journalists want to put in front of our readers? So if you send me stuff, not having spoken to me, that doesn't understand or doesn't make any reference to the kind of things that I'm interested in or the magazine's policy is interested in, it's going to be harder for you to get a hearing than if you've spoken to me and we've established some kind of working relationship. And it doesn't honestly have to be a 24-hour thing. As long as you understand a couple of the key things that people are interested in, you will find that it goes a lot easier. Yeah, if you're going to do it yourself, well, that's pretty obvious, but make sure they're well-written, relevant, and engaging. It can be hard sometimes to get all of those three bits together in the same release. And it's, you know, it is a craft in some ways, so make sure, if you're going to do it yourself, practice and read stuff to find out what is good practice, what looks like a good release. If you see a bit of news, look at it and think, now why did they get in and we didn't? Well, analyse it and find out. Yeah, and be prepared to get it wrong. I mean, obviously, none of us is perfect. It doesn't matter if you get it wrong. Like I said about deadlines, missing one, normally not a problem. But if you start getting it wrong more than once, then, yeah, things can possibly go a little bit worse. And if you're using a PR company, yeah, make sure they're right for your particular requirements. And don't be afraid to challenge them as well. If you think they're wrong, tell them they're wrong. If you think that you know best, because you're paying them, you're the customer at the end of the day, then let them know. Okay? So that pretty much wraps it up. There's a couple of things I made a note of that I hadn't covered. Social media was one. Crafting tweets for journalists to retweet. Some love it, some hate it. I don't mind it, frankly. I get stuff from quite a few people, which is essentially you're ready to go tweet. And would you mind retweeting this for us? that's quite a nice way of, you know, if you know the journalist, that's quite a nice way of getting a bit of news out there. We have about 5,000 followers, I think, on for our magazine. It's not a massive amount, I think. I don't really know. But, you know, it's 5,000 people who, when anyone sends a tweet from Education Today, it pings in their tweety inbox thing. So, yeah, ready-prepared tweets are always quite nice for me. I like them. Press launches and press events. Now, that's not something I've explicitly covered in this. They can be brilliant or they can be awful. And I think that's slightly outside of what I was asked to speak about today. But if you do organise a press event where you get as many journos as you can together, plan it and then plan it again, double plan it, because people will always not turn up. There'll be things. You make sure it's absolutely buttoned down. I know it's preaching to the converted. You wouldn't go in half cocked on a press event, but seriously, plan it and then plan again. Because if you invite 30 people, 10 might turn up, and then 2 will go at lunchtime, and then another 3 will be outside having a fag. So make sure everyone understands what's going on. And I think that's about it from me. Yeah, it's not an exact science, but you know, I hope some of those rules maybe might make life easier for you. I'm happy to help. That's me. Take all of that down. Any questions about editorial line policy? Would this work? What I'm happy to do is provide advice.
Just on that last point about press events, we've had a mixed bag of experience. I mean, we're not a London-based company.
Yeah.
Mainly the press and the PR companies are based in London. Is it better if we were to organise a press event for us to base ourselves somewhere in London centrally and to invite them to come to us, or is it to book out a couple of days and come down to London and visit the press at their offices?
It depends. You knew I was going to say that, didn't you? It depends. I think you need to. A press event in itself is not new. Is not really of great interest. I think you need to tie it to something. So if you're at BET, which you always are, or you have been in the past, or the Education Show or something, tie meetings around that because you would probably get.
Yeah, they've always worked. But yeah. If we've got a major release or a new part of a product and it doesn't coincide with one of the major events, and we want to get to the press, is it best done in that way, or is it best done in individual context?
I would advise against a major launch in a press event. You know the contacts, don't you? You know who you're talking to. You know who'd be interested in it. The danger in inviting a lot of people to an event, I think, is that you're going to get the tyre kickers and the sandwich nibblers and the free wine drinkers. But how much real benefit are you going to get back from it, Pat? I mean, you'll know better than I, having you've run events in town yourself, I guess. I mean, have they worked for you, as you say, or have they been a mixed bag where you think that's the last time we're ever doing that?
Probably been a mixed bag, actually. Yeah. Some have been very successful. Others have been a utter waste of time.
Yeah, and I mean, I know from my experience, for me, going to press events, I get a lot of invitations to go to these things. But I don't tend to go to many because there's nothing at these events necessarily that I couldn't get from talking to you. Do you see what I mean? When I'm if I'm on a deadline, I've got a magazine, I'm putting it together and I'm halfway through a feature. I know it's well flagged in advance and, you know, I probably should plan my week better than I do. But I think I'd rather be in the office doing what I'm doing than going out and standing around with a bunch of other hacks, standing and talking about a product. When I could go to you and say, so what's this about this new product launch then? Okay. It's just my personal thing. And, you know, having said that, I went to, there's a charity down on the Isle of Wight who offer apprenticeships and education for disadvantaged school kids on the Isle of Wight. And as you're probably aware in education, coastal towns have a terrible achievement record with school children. Pupils just achieve less and are more poorly educated than they are in many of the cities. And it's a geographical fact. The Isle of Wight has some of the worst performing schools in the country, which you wouldn't naturally think of. You'd think the Isle of Wight would be a nice place to live, but it has some areas of serious social deprivation, and the state school system is in a real shambles. No fault really of Hampshire's, it's just that there's a lot of transient workers, there's a high level of unemployment, so you get a number of different factors. This charity organises apprenticeships and education opportunities for 16 to 18-year-olds who are not getting on very well in education. And what it allows those kids to do is to get a trade, effectively, whether that's a silver service trade working on luxury yachts or, you know, whatever the hell it is, it gives them an opportunity. Now, they had a press event down on the Isle of Wight. I live in Sussex, down to Portsmouth or Southampton. It wasn't that big a deal for me to get down there. And there was the opportunity to meet a famous around the world yachtswoman. There was a trip out on a yacht around the Solent. So you see where I'm going with this. So there wasn't a free holiday to Barbados, but it was getting close. Cause, yeah, I like sailing. But that charity was only able to do that because, A, that was what they did, because they were they're a maritime training organisation and they train people how to do this for a living. They train masters of ships. So, you know, you've got Bill Gates or whoever in his £10 billion super yacht. They train people how to crew and to drive those things. So I went to that and it was very enjoyable and I wrote about it afterwards. That was a press event that worked. And I think it worked because it chimed with my interest in sailing because I like sailing. Plus it was a nice story. Plus I happened to be not busy that day. Plus you can see what I'm saying. There was a lot of hurdles that had to be crossed before I actually got myself down to that event. That interested me, so I did it. But if it had been something a bit less interesting, then I would probably just rung the person who'd sent me the invite and said, actually, I can't make it, but... And then what's the point of hosting the event and putting your people through all of that expense and hassle and worry when you could just be talking to people directly? I don't know, it's six of one, half dozen of the other, but I think there are hurdles in the way of people getting to events sometimes. Like you said, London-centric can be a problem as well. Because you guys aren't based in town, are you? So, you know, yeah, I don't know. It can be an issue. Anything else? Did you have something you were mulling over?
I was going to ask about the view from the classroom.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I was interested in that.
Yeah.
It's a two-page feature, which goes behind the school gates and looks at, as I said, an element of school life or a challenge or issue that's been overcome. Now, that can either be through good pedagogy, through the school itself, and we have many examples of that. Or we work with suppliers who have, say, innovative solutions in schools that allow... There's one that we ran on a company called Wise Pay, and they offer payment solutions, cashless payment solutions. And at first blush, that doesn't sound massively interesting, you know, and it doesn't sound like a piece of editorial. Maybe it'd make a nice piece of advertising. But as we got talking, and this was, at BET, as we got talking, we started talking about bullying. And bullying, particularly the old days of getting your school dinner money nicked and people using school dinner money for stuff they shouldn't be using it for. Now, most schools are cashless these days. But it started a train of thought in my mind about how cashless payments can take, A, mitigate the effects of that sort of thing, but also how they can improve the lives of children in schools and how, you know, getting a decent meal is an important part of a school child's life, and if they're sent in with rubbish packed lunches or if they're on free school meals and making sure. So it kind of opened out into a much broader piece. And that's what I'm always looking for, is the broader pieces. If WisePay, if we'd been talking, they said, you know, our system is super fast, it's the most secure, blah, blah, blah. That's just a series of selling points, selling a box which has WisePay stuff inside it. And I'm not necessarily as interested in that as I would have been, and as I was, as it turned out, in the human angle of it, in the benefit it had for the school in soft terms, yeah? So, but please, drop me a line, and we can take that on. Anything else? Anything else that I may have missed out? Yeah.
A little quick question.
Yes.
You said you were a monthly publication. Yes. I was just wondering whether there is, I don't know, a week in that month where you had a bit of a lull and you were looking for stories, whether there was kind of a magic week.
I'm always looking for stories. My deadlines, I did mention deadlines, are normally 3 weeks prior to the month of publication, if that makes sense. So for the July issue, my deadline was end of the first week of June for editorial. But that's not really hard and fast. I do that to keep the PR companies honest, if I'm honest, because I want to make sure they hit those deadlines. I can normally accept submissions up to and around, say, the last week of the month before, because I'm a pretty quick worker and my designer is great, so she can get stuff laid out pretty sharpish. So to answer your question, I'm always open for news, but if you want to hit a specific issue, then probably about 2 weeks before the issue date, effectively, would be a good time to start doing it. But again, a phone call at any time or an email is equally fine. I tend to work in sort of spurts and in fits and starts. I'll sit and think about something for quite a long time if I'm writing a feature. And then I'll just sit down and do it. It's like this presentation, you know, you can probably tell. But no, I did think about it for a while, and then I just sat down and did it. That's why it's not particularly fancy in terms of formatting. But I thought, right, I know what I'm going to say. And then in 3 hours, off the end of that comes a presentation. And that's how I write my features. So there's, you know, don't worry about interrupting me, because it would occasionally happen. But yeah, there is no golden week where I'm sort of sitting around looking out the window thinking what to do next. I wish there was, it'd be lovely if I could. Yeah.
What do you see as the three hot topics on teachers' minds in the next coming year?
Am I still going to be a teacher in a year? Mm-hmm. That's definitely what. Because there's a high level of dissatisfaction in the profession at the moment. I just don't have any time. That's the second one. Teachers are very time poor. Anything that can, again, talking this morning about that meeting I had with the Swedish company, their main plank was, this will save teachers time. What a great message, you know what I mean? Any classroom teacher will whatever it is, will say, yes, please, I'll have one of those, because they are overburdened. You know, the work, what was it called? The workload challenge. But they're time poor. So that's the second one. Then take one of a couple of issues, really. I think government policy is always contentious. Parental engagement, as I say, for me, but also for a lot of teachers. A lot of teachers want their children in the schools to be better supported at home. A lot of teachers I talk to say, you know, this kid is bright. If only he or she had the backing of the parent or parents, then that child could do so much more. That's always an issue. So those...
Sorry, there's another question there as well. So from 40,000 teachers, I assume you have a big following of head teachers.
We do have heads, yeah. I mean, a lot of them are classroom teachers, I would say. We do have heads. Yeah.
Do you think that those three topics are on their minds as well?
Certainly retention, yeah, certainly.
Would they be any different?
I'm not sure. Out of those, in terms of, yeah, the parental thing is a classroom thing, presumably. Retention, yeah, well, that's going to be important to a head. How do you keep hold of your best staff? Yeah. How do you stop disaffection from spreading in your school? I know Vic Goddard quite well. He was the head of the school in Essex. You know, when Channel 4 kicked off that Educating XYZ series, Vic was the head for that school, Passmore's Academy in Basildon. And he has perennial problems with disaffection in his school. And he's quite a strong leader. And because he's a strong leader, he manages to get his own way. And it's his rules or the road, basically. He's quite strong in that respect. So he has everyone working with him. But still, he says disaffection is a real problem in schools and retaining. So for heads, that would, I imagine, be one of the first issues they have. Bureaucracy for a head, again. You know, went into the profession to teach. My dad was a head teacher for 35 years, left the profession in the end because he was just sick of the paperwork. He wasn't doing what he wanted to do. Now, that, you know, presupposes that maybe he shouldn't have been a head in the first place. He should have stayed a classroom teacher. But it's still... paperwork, bureaucracy, time, the usual kind of things. But yeah, I'd certainly say the profession is facing a crisis, is overstating it maybe, but it's facing a problem in the next couple of years. There just aren't the numbers of teachers coming through now to satisfy the sort of organic people falling off at the other end of the conveyor belt. There aren't enough bright young things coming through despite countless government initiatives to get people into teaching. It's still going to be a problem in a few years. It's starting to manifest itself a little bit now. Teachers doing double duty and stuff in classes. So, yeah. Does that answer?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
Do you think that most of head teachers, are they supportive about academy or about academization? Because obviously that gives them more powers as a school head. Somehow we've heard the news, head teacher against the...
Good question. I think, you know, from a head teacher's point of view, it is a double-edged sword, academization. In one way, as you say, they have more control. But in another way... academisation is not a programme that a lot of the teaching profession is generally supportive of. They'll cite the fact that there is little evidence that academies have actually made much of a difference to children's outcomes, learning outcomes. They've got a smart uniform and they've got 20 million quid to spend on an IT suite, for example, but really, fundamentally, have the basics of education changed in an academy? Not really. I think practically, a head will always like to have more money and more control than less, so he'll probably come, or she'll probably come 60-40 in favour, but it's by no means a guarantee that, a head teacher will be thinking with his head one minute and then his heart or her heart the next, and say, actually, academies are not the best way to group schools anymore. And don't forget, a lot of heads come from a generation that didn't have academies. Maybe in 10 years' time, as teachers who have only worked in the academised system move up to be heads, they'll be much more readily accepting of it. So I don't think there's a cut-and-dried answer. I'd say for the most part, they would relish the freedom and the control.